Hello and welcome. Thank you so much for joining us this evening or afternoon or morning, wherever you are. We are delighted to have more than 60 of you already on the call, and I understand there's about 178 folks who have called in, so I'd really like to welcome all of you, our alumni, parents, Brandeis National Committee members, and friends from around the world. My name is Vipin Suri. I'm an alumnus of the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, class of 01, and I represent the Graduate School on the Brandeis Alumni Association Board of Directors. I'm a scientist by training, and I'm the Chief Scientific Officer at Catamaran Bio, which is a one-year-old startup in Cambridge that is developing new drugs for cancer. We have a fantastic panel planned for today. And what we will be talking about is how groundbreaking basic research discoveries lead to startup biotechs that discover and develop effective drugs. And we're seeing how important this is right now, right? The last 13 or 14 months have been a very difficult time for much of the world due to COVID-19. But there is light at the end of the tunnel, and a major reason for optimism is the vaccines that are proving to be highly effective in preventing serious disease. Vaccinated grandparents can hug their grandkids without the fear of getting sick, and we are hopefully on the road to recovery. What's enabled this speedy development of vaccines was new technology that was developed over the past decade or so, by two companies, Moderna, which is based in Cambridge, and BioNTech, which is based in Germany. And what enabled these startups that started around 2008, 2010, was basic research done in part by Professor Drew Weissman at University of Pennsylvania, a Brandeis alum, class of 81, and Caroline Carrico, currently at BioNTech. And they were basically asking why cells react in a certain way to messenger RNA. And those basic research questions ended up in the discovery and development of these vaccines that are now saving lives and helping us get back to normal. And so there are two key points I want to make here with this example. One is that going from basic research to these dramatic outcomes requires a lot of folks, and not just scientists, a lot of different folks to come together and work together. And secondly, by accelerating these interactions and getting more of these folks to talk to one another, we can really increase the pace of these innovations and developments. To learn about how these interactions spark innovation and how to accelerate these innovations, we have two of our own superstars from the Brandeis family that have effectively translated basic research into startups that are developing new drugs. On the basic research side, we have Professor Dorothee Kern, professor of biochemistry and an investigator of the Howard Hughes Medical Institute. Dorothee has been at Brandeis for about 22 years and has led a very successful research program looking at how large molecules called proteins move and sway. In addition to being a stellar researcher, Dorothee is also quite an accomplished basketball player. She was on the German national team, and you can still find her frequently at the Brandeis gym playing basketball. On the startup side, we have Kevin Gillis from the class of 89. Kevin is a partner and chief operating officer at Third Rock Ventures, where he leads operations, finance, legal, and a number of other functions. Kevin and Third Rock are a force behind many biotech startups in the area. They've been around for about 15 years and have developed a number of drugs for cancer, for neuroscience, metabolic, and other diseases. Kevin is also a sports aficionado, and he played on a men's soccer team during his time at Brandeis. In addition to his Brandeis bachelor's degree in history, Kevin also has an MBA from Bentley University. And together, Dorothee and Kevin have launched two startups, Relay Therapeutics and MoMA Therapeutics. With that, let's dive in. How are you, Dorothee?
Excellent. Just waiting for your first questions.
Would love to hear about your journey from growing up in Germany to becoming a professor of biochemistry at Brandeis.
Yeah, so I thought I'd give you a little story because all of the things what I'm doing now was totally non-planned. It started really following my passion, and that's what I would give the advice to all the young scientists. From my love for basketball, we're dancing proteins. So over here on the left, I'm playing basketball for East Germany because I grew up behind the Iron Curtain and practice macroscopic protein dynamics. I love dancing. And so what I realized that not only macroscopically, the definition of life is actually motion, but that's also the secret of the function of proteins. So I show you a protein here, a three-dimensional structure, so microscopically in vitro, but you might know proteins are our muscles or an egg, or what you just heard, actually the happy defense proteins our body is making if you get the vaccine right now. So it triggers that we are making response proteins which defend the virus. But of course, back in East Germany, we couldn't get those proteins, you know, made. So we had no equipment. So we went to the brewery over here and got out of the brewer yeast, purified our proteins. And then we measured them, you know, kind of by hand, right? Fast forward, how did I get to Brandeis? The wall came down. East Germany became United Germany. I played for the United National Team, and I had this big dream to come to America to play basketball and study science. So here we fast forward all the way to Brandeis. The big tank is not a brewery tank anymore, but it's a big magnet. It's actually the Lensman facility. It costs a little bit more money as well, $3 million, and thanks God to Manny, he actually built us a building. And so what we can do in this big magnet now can actually look at proteins at atomic resolution, right? I leave you with that. Macroscopically, we have to look at the dynamics.
Love it. Thank you.
I just leave you that without much words. I practice macroscopic protein dynamics in the gym, pick up basketball at Brandeis, and then my team of students and postdocs helps me to make real-time movies at atomic resolution. The only other thing I want to tell you, what is most important for life is ATP. You're consuming ATP here, and this enzyme that I'm studying in the lab is actually making ATP. So it's one of the most essential proteins. So with that, I give it over to Kevin.
Thank you, Dorothee. Hey, Kevin, how you doing?
I'm doing well, Vipin. How are you doing tonight?
Great. So Kevin, what does a partner at a venture capital firm do, and how did you become one?
Yeah, so let me pull up something as a backgrounder here. Yeah, so a little bit about Third Rock and how I got there, Vipin. So it wasn't really a destination that I had in my mind as I was navigating my business career. I'd actually started in high tech, went to Atlanta, Georgia, worked in the Coca-Cola company's headquarters for numerous years. And when I made the decision to move back to the Boston area, I was really intrigued by what biotech was doing. This is in the late 90s. And had an opportunity to join a company called Millennium Pharmaceuticals that was a high flyer and had a good career there, went to another company that went public. And three of the senior leaders at this company, Millennium, got Third Rock Ventures up and running in 07. And they started to recruit some of their colleagues from Millennium. And it was a unique moment in time. And I was really intrigued by their model. The basic premise behind Third Rock was it was at a moment in time where the ecosystem of biotech and drug discovery was really changing. Some of the amazing academic breakthroughs were taking places at universities like Brandeis. And at the same time, the pharma industry was really struggling internally. And so what Third Rock was trying to do was take some of those incredible discoveries and translate them into the next generation of new companies with an idea that the pharmaceutical industry would be there as a recipient. And so that was the idea. And over the years, we've had, as you can see with some of these stats, you know, tremendous amount of success working with folks like Dorothee. We now have 55 companies in the funded portfolio. We're operating out of 5 funds with nearly $3 billion in assets under management. And the capital markets in the United States have been very receptive to the type of companies that we've been building. You see here on the slide, 25 of our companies have become public entities. And that's based on all the idea behind our ability to get the companies quickly in a capital efficient manner into the clinic and start to really move the needle in terms of drug approvals. So I spend most of my activities on all of the operating activities that you mentioned on the initial part of the call today, Vipin.
Outstanding, thank you. Dorothee, going back to something you mentioned earlier, which is the moving protein and the ATP metabolizing enzyme that you had, what are some of the research questions that your lab is trying to address?
Yeah, so I gave you one example, and I told you already from the movies that what we want to understand is the absolute principles how proteins work in your body, right? The proteins control almost everything. So you see on the left side signaling, right? So that you can see me and transmit that signal. Membrane transport. So this is what I show you here, that drugs are exported out of the body. That's actually a bad thing, right? Catalysis, you know, anything that you digest your food, all the way that you make ATP is dependent on biocatalysts. Anything in your brain actually is controlled by proteins, right? The long-term memory. In your vision that you can see, right? So these are all happy natural functions. And then what we actually wanted to say is we want to understand those proteins in those functions. So we have to go beyond those static structures and look at these movies, right? So that is how those proteins function. And so what we really did is added the fourth dimension to structural biology and make real proteins, right? So now you see them making those happy proteins, doing hopefully good function in your body. But what we want to do in the second part, and that's really sort of the panel discussion, to use that natural built-in property of proteins that they are happily dancing to rationally designed very good medication. And so this is actually what we do, starting from what nature built to now take advantage of that to make much better medication with no side effects and curing diseases. Okay, so to understand the natural working function of your proteins is actually to understand how they evolved. So what I show you here, what we actually do in our lab, we recreate the evolution from 3.5 billion years ago, where the first living creatures arose on Earth, all the way to today. And one of the fundamental things in biology is actually where the energy comes from. And the energy comes actually from thermal energy, from temperature. Now, if we think about when Earth arose, we actually had a volcano on Earth. It was so hot that we had a lot of energy. Now we have very little energy because the Earth cooled down. The second part, these old organisms were very primitive. And I hope that we are a little bit more sophisticated today. Right? And so we are recreating that evolution starting from old ancestors and building them in our test tube all the way to you today. So these are the few questions we are actually answering in our lab.
Great. Dancing proteins. I love that. Where others see statues, you see jello, right? Kevin, question for you.
Yes.
Where do you mentioned Third Rock has been involved in companies that have discovered a lot of drugs. Can you explain a little bit more where venture capital firms sit in the discovery of new drugs? How do biotech start?
Yes.
And the role that you play and venture capital firms play in the formation of new biotechs?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've put this process together over the years that we call discover, launch, build, and transform. And it really reflects a strategic shift that Third Rock made over the years to focus our efforts on 100% company creation. So maybe unlike another investment firm or another VC that may be looking at existing companies, we felt that we had a unique ability to partner with professors like Dorothee on the early science. And I'll just show you the next slide briefly here. It's this concept we call group genius, Vipin, where we're constantly scouring the world and trying to find those next generation breakthroughs. You know, really, where is the science going? And we're really looking for the bolder initiatives. We're really not looking for a slight improvement on an existing technology. Our belief is to really kind of go big, and we are cautious in terms of our process. As you get a sense here on the slide, we have about 8 or 9 of our team members working on these various projects from a management standpoint, and then we set them up into separate projects. And over a couple year period, working closely with folks like Dorothee and other founders, we map out, in essence, the strategy for the initial investment. And so the initial investment in the Third Rock portfolio in today's fund are averaging anywhere from 60 to 80 million. We think that should take the company somewhere between 2 and 3 years forward. And ideally, the product engine, the initial science, is starting to develop the first couple of development candidates that we can start thinking about from a clinical development standpoint. And then the company at that time will go more now into what we call the build stage. So looking to raise another round of capital at what we call the Series B stage, probably in the 60 to 100 million is often what you're seeing there in build. And then one last financial transaction is called the crossover round. It's in essence the last private round before the company thinks about going public. And so Dorothee and Third Rock, we showed one of the brands, the name of the company is called Relay, really had just an incredible run through those private financings and has a beautiful technology that has a lot of investors super excited about it. We were able to take that company public just this past summer, and the company is sitting there today with a market capitalization north of $3 billion, which is just really remarkable. But it speaks to the vision that Dorothee and the other founders had at the beginning. And I think Third Rock had a unique ability to take that technology and really kind of prosecute it from a clinical development standpoint.
That's very, very helpful. And it reflects the enormous work that goes into these companies. So 2.5 to 5 years just to get to the build phase, and that's when you start your actual drug discovery program. So that's pretty amazing. Congratulations on the success of Relay. And now that you mentioned Relay and your other company, MoMA, as well, let me ask Dorothee a question about how these companies came together. So Dorothee, was there a specific experimental result or an aha moment when somebody walked in with a picture of a gel or something and you said, wow, we got to make a drug out of this? What was the,
when did you decide to make it? Of course, these are the best moments. So the best moments are these aha moments, right? but that was for sure not a gel. I just told you that that you're making atomic resolution movies, right? So the aha moment was first, I'll show you that. The aha moment was that we cannot rational design drugs, which is very frustrating, right? And the reason is that rigid body docking problem I just show you, right? Which all the biotech companies, all the pharma had been doing. And what is the problem? If you look where the drug is, it's actually an HIV drug. It's inside of the protein. If you look space filling, you can't even see it. So in other words, you know, if something goes inside, it can only go inside if the protein moves, okay? So clearly my passion, my dancing proteins should be the answer, right? That we have to understand the dynamic nature, how they can actually move in space and time. And we had the new vision, right? Put protein dynamics of the heart of drug design, but that's not enough to convince Third Rock or anybody to give you $65 million. you had to have a proof of concept. And the proof of concept was really that we looked at one of the best drugs on the market in cancer, which is called the wonder drug, Gleevec. And what we see with Gleevec actually is that it binds to the drug target, right? But it also binds, it looks like from the structure, it also looks to things it shouldn't inhibit, which are the happy proteins. And it doesn't. So the reason why it really inhibits very well the target, the bad protein, is because of the dynamic nature. And we characterize that in very much detail and found completely new principles how to make very selective and good drugs. The original nominal paper in 2015. But then we went one step further. And the big step further is a secret I tell you, right, is how can we even make better drugs where you really cure diseases and you're not having any side effects? So, you know, not losing your hair and so on. It's going to this called allosteric sites. You'll learn the new word. Allosteric means away from the active site. So here's where all the other drug companies go in. But the question is, why are we more sophisticated than a bacterial cell? It's because we actually have regulation versus these other sites. So in other words, these other sites evolved that we are more sophisticated, but that's why we should target them there. And so we had a very second big breakthrough to show that if we make drugs against those regulatory sites, that they are way better. So these were the two aha effects, which actually kind of got, resulted in that we teamed up with Kevin and Third Rock and started this, you know, amazing company with an amazing team at Relay Therapeutics, right? Here we see the website. And what are the secrets? Relay awarded number one workers place in the Massachusetts area. So you have to get a dream team together. You want to have a great environment. And the other thing which popped up, we were a Fierce 15, so you have to have one of the most innovative methods and approaches to actually be successful. So many thanks to the Relay team, right, that they made my dream become reality.
Fantastic. Well, thank you for that new addition to the vocabulary, Alistair.
I have one more thing, right? So just to bring it together, really the new dream and passion is you need dream teams. Here's my dream team at Brandeis, my own lab, right? Here's my Relay team. Here's the MoMA team. So the success to go to Health Avenue and Happiness Avenue is to have amazing teams to work happen. And so the common theme between academics and tech is really those moving proteins. But most importantly, I think, to me, is my dream team, my family, with my two daughters, Nadia and Julia, Gunther, my husband. In fact, I've published with both my daughter and my husband and future son-in-law. So they are kind of the stable point for the happiness. Thank you.
That's just great. And I couldn't agree more. I mean, teamwork is the key to success. I mean, drug discovery, above all, is a team sport. There's just so much effort that goes into it. Now, Kevin, what happened at the first meeting? So clearly, Dorothee's got fantastic research going. She's full of energy. And she shows you these dancing proteins and the allosteric sites. And how did you decide this is what you wanted to invest in?
Yeah, so it's a great question, Vipin. It is, you know, part of this process where our more scientific oriented members of our team, so similarly scientifically trained PhDs and MDs, are out meeting with folks like Dorothee on a consistent basis. We do a lot of vetting internally. We're also checking with some of our industry peers to really get a sense of what the opportunity could be. And then I think working closely with the founders and our extended team, we're trying to get a sense of where we could to take the technology and on what type of dollars, because it is at the end of the day, a business. And we have to be mindful that if we're putting, you know, large sums of capital in, we need to be able to move from a point in time today to a point in time in 3 years where we can actually now attract another investor to come in. And there have been many technologies over the years that we continue to be excited about, but they're probably still a little too early. And we actually think in those instances, it makes more sense for them to stay in the academic lab and stay in contact and stay in touch. And with the idea that that could be a company for us, you know, down the road. And I think it's that approach that is, I think, led to the success that we've had at Third Rock. We've had, in essence, very few results turn out to be zeros where, you know, the company just hasn't had success. And I think it's because we're asking a lot of these very critical questions while the dollars are kind of small and the attention we can give to it is a very important one here.
Thank you, Kevin. So a question for both of you. And maybe we can start with Dorothee first and then you, Kevin, which is that the theme of sports runs in a fairly significant way through both your careers. Dorothee played on the German national team. You played soccer at Brandeis. Did your shared passion of sports help in the formation of these companies? Did that help bring you guys together?
Okay.
There you are.
Here we go. Sorry, it just crashed for a second here. Okay, I'm back.
Yeah, so Dorothee, I was just mentioning your love of sports.
Yeah, so I think it's very simple. I think there's so many parallels between sports and running an academic lab, doing research discovery, or starting companies. It's really teamwork. I mentioned that before, right? And I just feel like I'm the, you know, I'm the point guard. I was always the point guard. I'm the point guard now with Brandeis, right? Or with the companies. What the key really is that you make everybody around you better. You have to find a secret how to, everybody's different. Everybody's individual. How do you get the best out of every person? And it's kind of simple. You make them happy. You make them really being proud of what they're doing and being part of it. And everybody contributes with their own personality, right? Definitely other credentials is you have to have a lot of passion. You have to have lots of energy. Speed is important, right? I mean, Kevin can speak to it. I mean, it is competitive, right? You know, we beat that virus with a vaccine in 10 months, right? So speed is everything, right? And then I would really say that you want to shoot big, right? So analogies to basketball again, right? And Kevin mentioned that again, you know, not doing something incremental, but what I'm really dreaming of to win the championship, right? Which I did on the right. So these are my teammates, my German teammates. We are defending world champions. But winning the championship means not just prolonging the life of a cancer patient for a few months, but actually curing them, that they are living really a healthy life. So these are the few credentials I would say, a lot of parallels, which I learned early on from sports, right? And finally, you can't be a perfectionist. You have to keep trying, working hard, and it's a long road to the journey, right?
Thank you, Dorothee. That's wise words for startups and wise words for life. And is that you playing basketball in fields?
Yeah, so this is my pickup basketball. These are my guys. Every day I play pickup basketball lunchtime, unfortunately not right now, but they prepare me always for the world championship. So these are my best friends.
Kevin?
Yeah, let me pull something up here to share. So similar, was a soccer player, you know, growing up and being a part of a team was really in my DNA, Vipin. And I think as I went into my business career, I naturally gravitated to settings where I could be part of product teams, product development teams in high tech initially, down at the Coca-Cola company, worked on, you know, their bottled water project. And when I got to Millennium, I had the opportunity to be part of the Velcade development, a drug that they got approved for multiple myeloma that became a huge success, and the impact it had on the patients, I think just kind of solidified for me that biotech is, you know, where I want to be. And from day one at Third Rock, we have instilled that type of sentiment into our culture because drug development is a very difficult business. You know, the odds of failure are incredibly high, and the resiliency, the teamwork, how you communicate, how you lean on each other in the early stages of a company being formed, and then how you navigate that as teammates is really critical. And we talk a lot about at Third Rock about the science is super important, the capital is super important, but often the company's success is often determined by the first 20 to 30 people that get hired into these companies and how they set the culture and the tone and how they think about, to Dorothee's point, going for it. Like, we want to be the best. They want to develop that and that mentality that I will do anything to make the company successful, this technology successful, because the person that's waiting for the success is ultimately the patient. And if that doesn't motivate you, you know, as a member of our industry, then you're in the wrong industry and you should go out and sell insurance or something like that. You shouldn't be in biotech or drug development.
Great. So it's the passion and keeping the eye on the ball.
Exactly.
That's the recipe for success. Excellent. Well, thank you for the background questions and answers. Now for the fun part, where we open this up to the audience to ask any questions for any three of us, frankly. And please put your questions in the chat box or the Q&A box. I see that there's some questions already, so let me pull those up. Okay, this one is for you, Dorothee, and it's for Sam Brower. I'm assuming one of the advantages of targeting an allosteric site rather than an active site is that undruggable targets can now be accessed. Has anyone been looking at potential allosteric sites for COVID-19 proteases?
All right, excellent question. Of course, one of, besides that the allosteric sites give you the selectivity, we have now made 100% selective inhibitors. The other thing that you said, we can go to which are deemed undruggable in the industry because the normal approach of going in the active site has failed, right? So one example are phosphatases, which are as important as kinase in cancer treatment. And the reason is because the active sites are just not druggable because they are so charged. So for the proteases, I mean, now for COVID, of course, everybody's screening, right? Trying to find, drugs against these different proteins. Of course, the important thing that we are actually having immunization. I think that's a way better thing than trying to treat after the fact. For treatment, I think it's a very good question you ask. I think it's really the principal understanding which will help us for future. So the way drug development really works that, we're probably too late for this COVID thing, but what we're learning will help us for future outbreaks. And I'm not aware of, there's not a single new developed drug for any of the proteins for COVID right now, but it's a very interesting question you raised there. And definitely these are sites you want to go after because they are very selective.
Thank you, Dorothee. Great question, Sam. A question from Jose Perez. How are you, Jose? On average, approximately how much does it cost to take a drug from initial investment to the patient? Kevin, this one's for you,
I think. Happy to share some of the stats. I remember a study that Forbes did probably 6 years ago, so somewhere in the 2015 timeframe, where they had looked at the last 14 to 15 years for the large pharma industry, and they divided their R&D spend per year, by drugs approved. And it was often in the four to sometimes, $8 billion per approved drug, which is really unsustainable longer term, I think, for our industry. And so in our own experience, the first company in our portfolio that was able to develop a drug, a company called Agios, which is in the cancer metabolism space, they ended up with a $1.1 billion cumulative spend to their first approval. And that I think is indicative of what we had hoped, that biotech maybe moving a little bit more nimbly, maybe a little bit more focused on what they're trying to do would lead to some efficiency in spend versus some of the larger pharma companies. There are a lot of layers of management, maybe not as risk tolerant. And I think that bodes well for the industry if we can start to drive the cost into the low. It's still a lot of money. I mean, $1 billion is $1 billion, but spending 6 to 8 per approved drug is a tough model for the large pharma companies to maintain.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Jose, for the question.
And maybe just to add to that, right? I mean, Kevin knows that even better, but maybe just to add to that, the research, the discovery is still the smaller fraction of the investment. It's really the clinical trials. And yeah. I mean, not being really in that field, I'm learning, but I really think also changes need to be made in the FDA, right? To make actually those clinical trials more efficient, right? And so it's really multidimensional, all the pieces which have to come together to finally have a safe and very good drug on the market, right?
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And it's a very important current discussion, given that FDA has gone above and beyond with the COVID vaccines to approve them as fast as they could and review them. And what can we learn that we can apply to other drugs and make sure they're available to the patients faster? So that is a very good point, Dorothee. Thank you for that. Question from David Stern. For Kevin, as a VC, do you feel that there is a higher rate of failure when investing in the discovery phase and having your own discovery versus investing in a more proven company in a Series A round?
Yep. Another excellent question. Yeah, I think in our experience, we have used our discovery process in a way that we think is a good use of capital, and it allows us to ask some of the really difficult questions while the cash burn is very low. And so often before you see a Third Rock company come out with a Series A presentation and we just raised 60 million, we may have already spent 5 or 6 million over a couple of years working closely with Dorothee and other founders and really asking the tough questions to give that company the best chance of success. And then in addition to that, from a risk management standpoint, we tranche all of our capital into our companies. And by that, I mean, the 60 million doesn't go all in on day one. 20 million may go in, and we work with the founders, the management team of these companies to say, these are the things we expect to get executed on over the next 18, 24 months. And a lot of that are, you know, progress that we want to see in the scientific setting, business development, hiring the management team. And there have been instances where we're 30 million into a $45 million A round, and we've had to shut the company down because the science hasn't progressed. We're hopeful that those are few and far between, because as COO, zeros in my portfolio aren't going to lead to a good outcome. So that's just a little bit about how Third Rock has gone about it. The last part of the question, for sure, you know, I think to look at opportunities, and we periodically will, if there's an existing company with a novel technology that one could argue has maybe been a little bit de-risked, we have an appetite to do some of those investments as well.
Yeah, maybe just to add to that, because it's perfect for this roundtable discussion, I really think the interaction between academic research and early biotech, and even that scouting phase, what Kevin just explained, this is really the model for success, and it's a win-win situation, right? Academics wants to work on things which are highly relevant for the public health. Funding by agencies and the NIH, the NSF, governmental funding is not sufficient to run our labs anymore, right? And for, on the other side, for early biotech, it's actually way cheaper and more rigorous to work with academics. So I think this new partner model is really the future of science. And I would finally say, you saw it right now, again, coming back to COVID, what really can happen and how fast then academics, but also different industries, different companies, finally get together and say, we have one goal and one goal only, to help people, right? And so I'm really hoping out of this pandemic, that we never go back to have closed doors and do something in competition, but rather together to cure diseases.
Great point. And the point you make about companies coming together for COVID is really key, because the Pfizer vaccine was developed by BioNTech and
in Germany.
Technology adapted by Pfizer. And similarly, J&J and Merck are working together. And that's, again, to make sure that people are healthy and get past this current unusual situation. So that was a very good question from David. And Dorothee, you started touching on this, a question that comes to us from Dan Kazaz. How do academic institutions profit from these activities?
Yeah, so I mean, I think there's many avenues. I just touched on it, right? That universities, the main focus of a university, of course, is to train the next generation. And I think that's what is really amazing what we do at Brandeis, right? So Brandeis gives us opportunities. We have cutting edge technology, right? We have great facilities and a full support of research, so that we can really create these amazing young scientists who then go out in the world and do those discoveries and help, right? But what is Brandeis getting back? I think what Brandeis is getting back is, of course, what I just said, with collaborations, early seed funding, where we can actually do this exploratory research. Of course, the next thing is we are recruiting the best scientists and we are recruiting the best undergrads, because they want to be part of it, right? I want to remind you that, you know, we have an undergrad from Brandeis who won the Nobel Prize. We have, the scientist who was a grad student in our department, actually in biochemistry, who was the key player at Moderna to do the key foundation for that we can do this vaccine. So these stories, right, enable Brandeis to really be absolutely cutting edge in science, right? And therefore an internationally very well recognized organization, which we need, right? We're smaller than Harvard and our big brothers down the road, but I would say Brandeis is a jewel, right? It's excellence, a little bit comparable to biotech, right? Not big pharma, you're excellent and you're little, and it's about quality and not quantity and efficiency. But it's a really good question because yeah, the question is what is Brandeis profiting from those interactions?
Excellent. Yeah, Brandeis may be small, but it packs a punch with several star researchers and also stellar programs for students. Thank you for the question. And the next question is from Randy Hampton. With early stage therapeutics, what first round funding options are available? Are VC funds like yours and the only and or the best option and why? I assume this is for you, Kevin.
Yeah, another excellent question. And obviously being in the seat for 13 years, I think a lot about what we do and maybe why we are a value add. A lot of the why I feel that way, it does come back to the original thesis of Third Rock. There was a belief that our three founders shared that the venture model had kind of lost its way, that venture was really a little bit risk averse and really not leaning in. And, you know, often backing an investment, but challenging an entrepreneur who maybe had no real experience building a biotech company to go and try and navigate what is often a very difficult path. And so for us, and I think the pitch that we make to folks like Dorothee and others is you've got within the partnership, folks that have often spent 20 to 30 years building some of the most well-known biotech companies. And that ability to work closely with the founding science team to translate those ideas into companies and then navigate those companies, we think is the right way to do it. And we were pioneering that a bit in the early days of Third Rock. But if you look at the landscape today, people have been paying attention. And so folks in town like Flagship, like Atlas on the West Coast, like Arch, like Versant, like 5AM, the space that we were competing in the early days has gotten incredibly more crowded. But it's back on that fundamental belief that this marriage of venture in academia is the right way to go about building the next generation of companies and ultimately drugs.
Thank you. Question from Oliver. Can you speak about some of the ethical issues when academics work with companies? Dorothee, you want to take this one?
Yeah, I mean, ethics is a broad word, right? So I'm not quite sure, Oliver, where you're going. So maybe you can type in in which direction you go. So let me start with, of course, academic research has to be available to everybody, right? And I mean, that is sort of also the big advantage. So the one thing which is hard for me, but now as a founder, advise on the companies that we can't talk about the exciting new research, right? And so in academics, of course, we talk about all the results, we brainstorm about it, which we can, with companies like Wheeler and MoMA, can only do internally, right? So ethically, maybe you mean that one cannot give an advantage financially to one company versus the other. And there are really very good mechanisms in place anyway. So I'm also a Howard Hughes Medical Institute investigator. So that's actually the people who fund my lab and so on, and a lot of equipment. And they do not allow me to directly collaborate with a company that I'm a founder, right? So it's automatically that there's a nice separation between academic research and then once a company starts, which is also better anyway. So I think it is very good that when you found a company that you give the company, the CEO, the CSO, the directors, the vice, and all the employees, the full power. It's their baby and they make it happen. So the way I'm advising those companies is really that I believe in their excellence and that they are taking over to crack the problem, right? So that they're, and we're already working in an academic lab on the next high risk question. So coming to high risk, we can take high risk, right? We don't have to make a drug. So I think it's a good separation between high risk and proof of concept in academics. And then in order to ever make drugs, you have to have, you know, VC funding and millions of dollars in a company. So I don't know whether that answers your question.
You did. Oliver? And Oliver clarified that he was asking financially. So you did. Yes. Yes. That's the question. Next question is from Alan Bertman. Investors are interested in key customers or vendors, as well as the market size. Without those two factors in an early startup, what other factors do you consider in an early stage biotech startup?
Yeah, I think it comes back to people in working with, you know, the rock stars of the industry. I think it's really important for us to keep a very high scientific bar because, you know, at the stage we're talking about at discovery, even into early launch, we really aren't at that point where we're knowing even the type of indication that a company may be going into. I look at oncology, for instance. We may have an excellent technology that we're developing, but until that technology matures, we may not necessarily know what type of cancer, you know, the company wants to go treat. So it really does come back to what's the academic institution, you know, what is the pedigree of that scientist? Is there a group of scientists working together in a similar area that we could put together and build a spectacular company? Those are a lot of the ingredients, you know, that we put into our analysis as we're trying to ask those tough questions during the discovery phase.
Thank you. That is the list of questions that's on there. I would encourage the 85 participants, if you have additional questions, please do submit them. Oh, there is a question from Sam again for Dorothee. I don't understand how the mRNA of the mRNA COVID vaccines leave the exosome and gets into the cytosome, since the lipid membrane excludes molecules greater than 500 daltons. Mm-hmm. Typically, it takes months for a biologic drug to be fully metabolized, but the mRNA vaccines seem to get in very quickly, about 24 hours. The assumption is that there is some disruption of the membrane to allow the mRNA through, but has anyone looked at this?
Okay, excellent question. Very technically, so in order not to lose the other 85, I would just want to summarize. Basically, the messenger RNA is the thing which actually encodes that you finally make those proteins, the defense proteins, the antibodies, which will fight off COVID, right? But of course, it has to get into the cell. And messenger RNA is very charged, so it would not go through your membrane. And so the second ingredient in the COVID vaccine is actually cationic lipids. And that is a difference between Moderna and the Pfizer vaccination is the details of this cationic lipid. So basically you have a negative charge MRI, you cover it up with a positive charge lipid, and then it zoops, goes into the cell within actually seconds or minutes. Now, why is it so important to explain that? First of all, it answers your question. That's why it goes into no time. Second, lipids, of course, biological natural materials. So there is absolutely no risk. So there is no side effects, right? And that's the difference, for instance, to the AstraZeneca vaccine, which is delivered by adenovirus. So the biggest breakthrough, there are two big breakthroughs with these mRNA vaccines, which makes it revolutionizing and no risk whatsoever. mRNA cannot do anything except making that happy protein which fights off your the COVID, and then it gets degraded and it's gone. A lipid, you know, it's basically when you eat some butter, right? It gets degraded, right? So there is no component in these vaccines which has any artificial thing in there, right? Basically, right? So this mRNA delivery that was developed many years ago. That's why we could develop the vaccines within 10 months, because all this methodology was developed. We are using that technology to deliver DNA for research in our cells. We even hijacked that delivery to put our allosteric protein inhibitors into cells. So we use these cationic lipids just to put anything in the cell. But this is really a very good question. I hope it explains to the non-experts why the Moderna and Pfizer vaccination is so cool and so safe.
Excellent question and excellent answer. We're getting some fantastic questions. The next question is from Chris Doyle. Could you comment on current controversies around ownership of IP related to the COVID vaccines? IP around COVID vaccines, any information there, Kevin or Dorothee?
I'm the wrong guy on that one, unfortunately, Vipin.
Yeah. Sorry, Chris, I don't know either. But what I'm very encouraged by is that people are getting the vaccinations at very low cost or free worldwide. The vaccinations are going to lead us out of this pandemic. You ask a good question, and I apologize.
I mean, there's always so much in the media, so sometimes I'm not even sure whether there's actually that much controversy, right? But I agree with both of your answers. I'm really happy as a scientist to see that the real treatment supersedes or overrides any IP issues, if there is. So I'm very happy about that.
That's right. A fantastic question from Melissa Brennan. It's for you, Dorothee, which is a question that I want to ask you as well. How do you balance all your different roles? Teaching, research, starting companies, basketball, family, and finding time to sleep. What is a typical day or week for you?
Yeah, so maybe let me start with a nickname. You know, the basketball teams where you go to these world championships gave me. So my nickname is actually, my usual name, people call me Doro, and they call me Doro Cell from Duracell. So, so they ask the same question. Do you just stick two fingers in the outlet and then recharge in the morning, right? So my nickname is Doro Cell. I think it's genetics, right? And so that would be kind of a joking answer, but the way I approach things, that I do things I love, and things which are harder to do, I try to get it done efficiently. My grandmother actually gave me some very wisdom. He said, you know, you have to do a lot of things you don't like, but if you try enjoying them, you will get them done much quicker, right? But really to the balance, what I would say is you have to always set priorities. And the priorities early on was professional basketball. Eventually I had to make the hard call when I came to the States that I had to give that up, right? So priorities change. Second, you cannot be a perfectionist. I would call myself, I wing a lot of things, right? And finally, it's all about quality over quantity. So. And I think that's really, really important that you say, okay, where can you focus on something right now and you want to do it to really excellent. And for excellence, it's actually quality and not quantity. So I quite often think first about a little longer what I want to do and how I want to approach it. So for instance, science, you know, don't do the experiment from A to Z, but maybe you can only with two or three experiments, you get the full answer. So you can get it done in a much quicker way. So it's really about quality versus quantity and not try to be a perfectionist, right? But finally, I would say sports, family, these other things are actually giving me the energy to be better in science and in my job as well. So the balance is actually a strength and not a dragging time away, I would say. So. Really good question. Everybody have to find their own style, and it's a constant learning. It's juggling, right? You want to do 50 things, but you can only get 10 things done a day, and you have to be okay with that.
Love it. Next question is from Lakshmi Miller Vaden for Kevin. How do you decide on the breadth of focus of a new biotech company? More specifically, how do you balance focusing on hard, aka fascinating, problems while still being able to convince investors it's doable?
Yeah, that's something we wrestle with all the time. And it goes into that process I referenced as discovery, where we're starting to map out you know, what we think the size of the Series A can be and where we think it's going to get us. And it's very important in that phase where we are driving the initial progress on maybe the first program and or programs, and all at the same time, developing what we call are these product engines, you know, this platform of technologies that we hope would allow the company to have multiple opportunities as it gets closer to the clinic. Because I think anyone who's been in our space understands if a company unfortunately is pioneering maybe just one drug, you are often setting yourself up for a binary outcome clinically. And I think we've all unfortunately been in those instances or seen those instances where the card gets turned over and you're in a tough spot. So that balance by which you're prosecuting the early programs, keeping enough capital going toward the engine is a fine balance that we spent a lot of time at Third Rock thinking about. I think for that next round of financing beyond the A, in order to kind of see that investor appetite, I think demonstrating that you are on that trajectory, that you kind of have met your Series A deliverables, you're at that point in time that you expected to, and then to be able to show the investor what you're going to do with that next 60 to 80 millions is part of the equation.
Thank you, Kevin. Great question, Lakshmi. Next question is from Patrick Devon. How close are we to having truly personalized medicine that's customized to each person's genetic profile? Dorothee, you want to take that?
I take it. I don't care.
Why don't you take it? And I'll add one comment that I comes to mind, but I'd love to hear what you have to say.
Yeah. So, of course, what's really great that we can now very cheaply sequence the genome of every patient. And I think that's really the key where I would say personalized medicine, meaning we can find easier, I mean, it's still complex because they're complex signaling pathways, likely reasons, targets which we have to target. And so we're getting much closer because of that, right? Of course, financially, you cannot say, you know, you can go for each single person gets a different drug, but you don't need that, because these are common mutations, common alterations, right? Which then need to be fixed. Of course, the second part of the equation is eventually CRISPR, whether we could actually take the wrong, you know, nucleotide out and put the right one in, right? So I would say we're getting much closer to that, particularly the diagnostics, yeah. what we want to target.
And that's what I was going to add. One of the successes that we've had at Third Rock was a company in the cancer space known as Foundation Medicine. And it was, in essence, developed that when a poor patient who progressed with cancer, when their tumor was assayed, our testing was often enlightening the oncologist to look at potential therapies that they may not have known that patient would respond to. And that became a very successful product, actually two products that are on the marketplace, and Roche, the large pharma company, ultimately bought that company because of the success that they were having.
Thank you, Kevin. Good question, Patrick. And the next question is from Pascal Fortin. To both Kevin and Doro, what fledgling therapeutic modalities or technologies most excite you and could have the potential to significantly change human health in the next decade or so? That is, what are you excited to start up next?
It had to come from Pascal. He wants to get the secrets out. So I would give me two answers. I'm very excited about the possibility what we did as a proof of concept in our lab to use small proteins as drugs, because they are very selective and they're very easy to develop, and they are biological materials. And so far, they have been very successful as extracellular drugs, right? Antibodies and so on. So the technology I'm most excited about, and we have to find, you know, companies who can finally crack it, is the delivery of small proteins or in form of mRNA for this protein in the cell, so that we actually can use biologic small proteins as intracellular as drugs. So that's number one. And number two is to be able to big scale rationally design enzymes for all kinds of biotechnological applications, right? I mean, including plastic degrading enzymes and so on, that we actually can rational design it based on the knowledge we have about enzyme catalysis and then machine learning. So really that we are completely revolutionizing all aspects of life by biocatalysts. So I would say these are the two most exciting things I would like to crack next.
Great, Kevin?
Yeah, I'm gonna reference one of the companies that we got up and running. It'll be 2 years old in May. And it's a company with another diagnostic, but this one was in the early cancer detection space, a company called Thrive, that's using a technology that was developed at Johns Hopkins University using a liquid biopsy. And the hope there, the company was recently acquired by Exact Sciences at 18 months old, is that on a standard of care basis, every year when you go in to have your blood pressure checked and your cholesterol checked, you would be administered the Thrive test. And the hope there is that it would have the ability to predict that 5 or 10 years from now, you have a tendency to develop, you know, various cancers. And as everyone knows, the cancer space, if an oncologist is getting that news much sooner and not waiting to pancreatic cancer showing up at stage 4, ovarian at stage 4, there's really nothing much that the doctor can do versus if they have line of sight to that, I think the treatment options become abundant. And so that company now will start a very large phase 3 study. And in the next 2 to 3 years, we'll start to see the data. And I think it could be a game changer if everything were to work.
Outstanding. So mini proteins, designer enzymes, and diagnostics. That's the bet. So this is way too much fun, but we are at the hour. There's one last question from anonymous attendee. And as I read that question, I'm also going to ask you for closing comments, Kevin and Dorothee. And the question is, what have you been most impressed with about Brandeis science students and getting to work with them to do this incredible research?
Man, these are so amazing questions. You know, I would just hire some of those people to ask these questions. So what is very important in science, that you're always humbled and that you're hungry to learn, that you want to work as a team and you understand how little we understand. So there's this combination between hunger to learn and being humbled, but at the same time, confident that you can make a big impact. And what I see in Brandeis, we tend to attract students in this category. So, you know, I did my postdoc in Berkeley, and, you know, of course, I go around the world giving talks, and some of these very high name universities, sometimes you have the tendency that people really fool themselves. And so students who think they know everything, and they are the overachievers. And I think that is the death penalty for research and discovery. And so what I really like with Brandeis students, that they are not like that, right? But at the same time, I think we have an environment at Brandeis where there is not this cooker pressure environment. We allow them to explore and to exploit and to look into different directions. And that's the other thing you need to do in science. You cannot say in 2 months, you have to have this problem solved. It's a journey, and you have to be able to breathe free, to think free, to exploit your ideas. And I think it's the environment of Brandeis which allows that. And what I have seen with my grad students and undergrads, this amazing growth from where they started and where they ended up when they graduated. And they made it happen. So they took their own journey in their own hands, and they were proud of all the struggles and all the puzzling together in their growth. And I would say that's sort of the secrets of Brandeis, of our students, but also about our professors, our environment. This distinguishes us from many other universities.
That is very well said. Kevin, any closing comments from you?
Yeah, no, I look back on my time at Brandeis, you know, very fondly. It wasn't really sure where I was going to end up, you know, in my business career. But I think the ability for the university to develop an ability for me to communicate, I think as a finance professional, I've used that along with just a sense of teamwork to really dig in and kind of be that solid teammate on various projects over the years. And I a couple of things that Dorothee said, I think of the university as a very scrappy university as well. And I my mom has often characterized me as a bit of an overachiever. And actually, that's one of my most favorite compliments, because I really do think that people, you know, shouldn't be resting on your laurels every day. Get out of bed and work as hard as you possibly can for what you're excited and passionate about. And that's kind of how I've lived my life. And I really do appreciate everything the university gave me, you know, from a solid footing to embark on this very exciting career.
Thank you, Kevin.
I would close to thanking everybody in my closing remarks. You know, you could be sitting in front of, you know, Netflix that everybody dialed in. I love the questions. You know, I think really helping to make the world a better place, whether it's training the next generation, you know, that big translation that I had the privilege to now work with Third Walk, with Relay, with MoMA, with amazing people. I owe them everything, right? My teammates in basketball, my family. So I really think it's the people you surround yourself, and they are really the answer. And so I'm just really glad that people dialed in and asked some questions. Please reach out to us. You'll find us on the internet, right? The best part is really the communication. I hope we can meet each other in person very soon, because I'm a very personal person and this Zoom is really hard. But it was really fun to have people interested in this kind of geeky question. And you know, we are hoping to help a little bit, as much as we can do, the world to make it a better place.
Oh, that's great. It's the people that you surround yourself with. And I am blessed that I was surrounded for the past hour and a half with Dorothee and Kevin and the 80 plus people who joined in the conversation. Thank you so much for your time. Thanks to Allison and Lauren for organizing the event, and for Menon for the tech support. This has been a fantastic event. And appreciate all the questions as well.